Good morning. We welcome you to beautiful Savior Lutheran Church. We're glad to see that you're here to worship with us this morning. This morning, Pastor Tom is going to be bringing us into John chapter 4 to talk with us this morning about a crucial conversation, one that Jesus has with the woman at the well and one that Jesus still has with you and me today. And so we pray for God's continued blessings on that message, that he would open our hearts and minds to hear those words and also to receive the gifts that he so freely gives this morning. Would you please stand? And our worship begins in the name of our God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. He will call upon me, and I will answer him, says the Lord. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. During these weeks, the church meditates on what it means that God made Christ to be sin, that we might become the righteousness of God. We gather on the road marked by mournful ashes. As we experience Lent, we hear God's covenant promises of old, seeking mercy, open to service, seeking forgiveness, and preparing for the great immersion of the Paschal mystery at Easter. Our liturgy this morning will be found on the screens. Let's join in singing our gathering hymn. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another this morning. Redeeming Lord,
as we join our Savior on the Lenten journey, by His grace and the power of the Spirit, we are bold to speak the prayer of a repentant King David. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit.
Amen. Dear friends, I have the honor and privilege by the grace of God announcing to you the entire promise of the forgiveness of your sins. This is all because and through Jesus Christ as our Savior. Because in Jesus Christ, you are forgiven and you are free. Free to share the steadfast love of God with all. Amen. God, the fountain of living water, you quench our thirst and wash away our sin. Give us this water always. Bring us to drink from the well that flows with the beauty of your truth through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Heidi.
I would like to invite the kids to join me up front, please. Good morning. Bring a special friend today. So good to see you guys. Well, good morning, everyone. We are going to talk today about, what's this? Water. Is water important to us? Absolutely. We need water to live, don't we? We can't survive very long without drinking water. Water keeps us healthy, keeps our body hydrated. It gives us a lot of good stuff. And we need to drink a lot of water every day, don't we? Have you ever gone to the grocery store and seen how many different kinds of water they have? There are a lot of different kinds of water. Here's a kind of water. This water comes in a can. Has anyone tried this? It's kind of fizzy, grapefruit flavored. Okay, here's one kind of water. Here's another kind of water. This is called vitamin water. This water claims to have vitamin C, vitamin B, vitamin B5, vitamin B6, vitamin A and E, and zinc, and electrolytes. Sound good? Yeah. But you know, if you drink this water, or this water, or this water, which is really the best for you, are you going to need to drink more? Absolutely. You're going to get thirsty, and your body's going to need more. In a few minutes, Pastor Tom's going to read from God's true word. And he's going to read about a time that Jesus was traveling through an area called Samaria. And you know what? He was hot, and he was thirsty, and he needed a drink. And while he was there, he got into a conversation with a woman while he was sitting by a well, and he asked her for a drink of water. Do you know what he went on to tell her? He said, "Do you know what? I have a special kind of water. I have a gift. It's living water. And if you drink this water, you'll be thirsty. But Jesus says, if you drink my water, you will never thirst again." Water that we drink and we never thirst again. Now, Jesus wasn't talking about this kind of water, but do you know what, you guys? He was talking about the gift of eternal life that he gives to us. Think with me for a minute. The God of the universe, the God who made the universe, the sun and the stars and everything in the sky, he loves us. And he loves us so much, you guys, that he chose to be born. And he chose to live a perfect life. And he chose to die. And he rose again so that he can give us this gift of eternal life. And do you know what, you guys? He lives in us, and he promises he will never leave us. But do you know what? We have this gift of eternal life, and he wants us to share it with others. And do you know what, you guys? As we go through our weeks, he's going to give us opportunities to share his love with others in our neighborhood, with our friends, with our family, at school, at daycare. All those ways, or in all those places, God's going to give you opportunities to share his love with others. It's a pretty awesome gift, isn't it? Would you pray with me, please? Dear Jesus, thank you for the gift of eternal life. Thank you that you are always with me. Help me share your love with others this week. Amen. Thanks for coming up, guys. Have a good week.
A reading from Exodus. All the congregation of the people of Israel moved on from the wilderness of Sin by stages, according to the commandment of the Lord, and camped at Rephidim. But there was no water for the people to drink. Therefore the people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." And Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water, and the people grumbled against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried to the Lord, "What shall I do with this people? They are almost ready to stone me." And the Lord said to Moses, "Pass on before the people, taking with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile, and go. Behold, I will stand before you there on the rock of Oreb, and you shall strike the rock, and water shall come out of it, and the people will drink." And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel, and he called the name of the place Massa and Meribah because of the quarreling of the people of Israel, and because they tested the Lord by saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
reading from Romans. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Praise to you, O Lord.
So he, who was Jesus, came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, so Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. A woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God, and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come here." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband,' for you have had five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things." Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am he." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, on this beautiful, bright Sunday morning in March, I have to ask you if you're all recovered and if you've all gotten yourself adjusted during the last week. Well, to daylight saving time, I mean. I can't say this for sure, but I think there's more of you here than were here last week at this hour, so I guess you have adjusted. But spurred on by a devotion in one of the devotion books Kristen and I use at home, Dale Meyer, the president of the seminary in St. Louis, his devotion book, Timely Reflections, and also informed by history.com, I, over the last couple weeks, have been, for whatever reason, wondering what this daylight saving time thing is really all about and what its history. And I have a little bit of it to share with you today. Some of you have heard this a little bit already as Lon marked his retirement the other day. But let me share with you that daylight savings time, first of all, if you think it was Ben Franklin, you're wrong. He gets credit for a lot of stuff, and that actually Ben Franklin was concerned that people should change their sleeping habits, not the time. He was onto something a little bit more than the guy I'm going to tell you about. It was Englishman William Willett who led the first campaign to implement daylight savings time. And I'm sorry, it's daylight saving, not savings. It's saving time, and that's important, I guess. While this is what history.com relates about William Willett. While on an early morning horseback ride around the desolate outskirts of London in 1905, Willett had an epiphany that the United Kingdom should move its clocks forward by 80 minutes between April and October so that more people could enjoy the plentiful sunlight. The Englishman published the 1907 brochure, The Waste of Daylight, and he spent much of his personal fortune evangelizing with missionary zeal for the adoption of what he called summertime. Not summertime, but summertime. Okay? Year after year, however, the British Parliament stymied the measure, and Willett died in 1915 at age 58 without ever seeing his idea come to fruition. And it probably would have mortified him a year later when the Germans adopted daylight saving time. They were the first one to do that to aid in their war effort for World War II. The United States also engaged and used daylight saving time to help the war effort during World War I, repealed it immediately after the war was over, and then reinstituted it in World War II. For the aid of the war effort, and repealed it 3 weeks after the end of World War II. And then what happened from then until 1966 resulted in total chaos of time in the United States. And states and cities were setting their own times for one simple reason. They could. And I don't know if some of you remember this here, but I read that in the 1960s, St. Paul actually set their clocks ahead 2 weeks ahead of their sister city of Minneapolis just to prove they were ahead of Minneapolis. Okay. Finally, then, in 1966, Congress adopted the Uniform Time Act, and daylight saving time as we know it, or as some of us remember it, from April to October, went until January 1st, 2007, when what we know to now as March to November, was enacted into law. And to this point, only two states don't use it, and that is Arizona and Hawaii. Now, why did I tell you all that? Okay? One simple reason. I wanted to say this to you. Aren't you glad God's love for you in Christ has no effect, is not affected at all by humans' ideas that they can control time? Aren't you glad about that? That all of the things that humans bring to the table are dwarfed. They're just dwarfed by God's love. And the concept of time is an important one in our gospel reading today. But it's time as place, and that's what I want to talk with you a little bit about today. It's a very long gospel, John chapter 4, verses 5 to 26. And actually, we took the shortened version, and I was regretting that decision during this week, okay? And I know if you're worried about the time, that might have upset you if we would have read all 40-some verses. But in order to understand the whole deal of Jesus and the woman at the well, you have to get the context. And the context is actually in the first four verses. Listen for the importance of time and place as I read these. Now, when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself did not baptize, but only his disciples, he left Judea and departed again for Galilee. And he had to pass through Samaria. He had to pass through Samaria. And that speaks volumes about both time and place. Because the truth is, physically, Jesus did not have to pass through Samaria. You could go the other way to go north, back to Galilee, and you could cross the river and go the other way. It would take you a little bit longer, but in reality, that's what most of the Jews did, because they didn't want to have anything, as John informs us, they didn't want to have anything to do with the Samaritans. But Jesus, John records this for us. It's a very important word. He had to go through Samaria. And then we find him with the woman at the well. You see, the had to, the requirement of going through Samaria had nothing to do with time. It had everything to do with place. With place. It had everything to do with the mission of God that Jesus had come to bring to the world. It had everything to do with his love for all the world. Because that place was also included in the salvation and redemption, and the people who lived there were also included in the redemption and salvation that Christ had to bring. And the fact that at the end of John 4, toward the end of John 4, at the end of the story of Jesus and the Samaritan woman, listen to the upshot of it. And by the way, it was quicker to go through Samaria to get from Judea back to Galilee, but Jesus doesn't seem to be in any hurry. In fact, this place and time that he spent with the woman at Sychar and with the townspeople, he stayed 2 days. So time wasn't of the essence. But listen to the outcome of his time there and his conversation, a crucial conversation that he had with the woman at the well. This is verse 39. Many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me all that I ever did. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, "It is no longer because of what you said that we believe. For we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is indeed the Savior of the world." You see, for Jesus and for God, again showing us how unique Christ's coming into the world is, okay? We treat time in our culture as a commodity, don't we? I mean, think of the phrases we use, just over daylight savings time, spring forward, fall back, we lost an hour. Really? Really? We think we're in control of how the earth spins, lose an hour, and then next fall, you know what we'll say? What will we say? We gained an hour. Folks, time is a commodity, and I've even heard it said, I've even said it. Time is the most precious commodity we have. But what is the importance of time? It's the places where you're at. I mean, time itself is just out there. It is what it is. You get so many hours of daylight at certain times. You get so many hours of night at certain times. It's the places where you find yourself that matter. It's the places where you find yourself. Just like Jesus, he had to go to Samaria for the sake of the mission. And so it is for us, the places we go determine what use we make of our time. The places we go after we have been to this place. Oh, and by the way, when I came out, didn't I say that? I whispered over to Kim and Pastor Joe and Joan, "Wow, look at how many people came to the well today. You came to the well today. This is the same place And the same Lord is here to meet you as it was for the Samaritan woman. You came to the well today. And Jesus the Christ is here to feed you water. He is here to feed you living food, the gift of Himself. You've already been fed in the absolution. Those children were fed by Heidi up here in the front. We will be fed in the Eucharist with the Christ, the same Jesus who was at the well in Samaria is here at this well. And then what happened after that was she went back into the town. And she said what she knew about this Jesus, and she did it at the place she lived. What places will you live in this week, friends? What places will you live in? Husbands, wives, you have a place. It's called your marriage. And your marriage needs to be tended with loving care and gentle spirits. Parents, you have places. They are called your family. And your children need to be raised in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. For the time you have them in your home, and even when they leave, they need your prayers, your love, your support, and your encouragement. Children, you have a place. And that place is to obey your parents in the Lord, for this pleases God. And when you're past that obedience stage, you are there to respect them in their place, because they are still your parents. You have places, they're called businesses. You have folks you interact with in those places. They're called colleagues. And they are human beings who need to hear of the love of Christ and need to see from you and give them the dignity that they have as ones who are made in the image of God. We have places that fill our time. I read a great quote this week, folks. And it was directed at parents. It said, "Moms and dads, you really should be more concerned with what happens in your house than what happens in the White House." Okay? Absolutely. We have places we go, and that fills our time. But it starts in this place. As the Savior of the world feeds us with Himself. As He takes the time to come to us today, as He takes and sets up residence in this place and then in your heart. Because I noticed one other thing about when we try to fudge the clocks and we think we gain and lose hours. Christ is still here the next morning. Christ is still here. Feeding His people at the well and sending them out to experience a good Lent in all the places we go. Amen? Amen.
Would you please stand? Living together in baptismal trust and hope, we confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended.
Standing for prayer. Lifting our voices and turning toward God, let us pray for the church, the earth, and all who are in need.
O God, Let your church on earth, justified and reconciled through Jesus Christ, be bold in its proclamation of the gospel here and at Bethlehem Lutheran Church in Aiken, South Carolina, and Good Shepherd Lutheran Church in Franklin, Indiana. Boldly use Reverend Joe and Deaconess Dr. Jenny Asher to share your good news as they serve as missionaries in Germany. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In your hands are the depths of the earth and the sea which you made. Make us faithful inhabitants of this earth, caring for the waterways and their creatures. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lead the nations of the world away from the wilderness of sin and evil and toward the light of love and peace. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
To those who are thirsty for love, for justice, for peace, for belonging, give the water of life. For those who are suffering or in pain, bring healing, balm, and peace, especially those we name before you now, silently or aloud. Hear us, O God. Strengthen families, guide parents and caregivers, and enfold children with the riches of your grace, especially the newly baptized Lauren Alexa Gunderson. Hear us, O God. Protect workers at construction continues on the Child Development Center, and stir parents to seek the center as a place for children to experience Christ's love. Empower Jan Stockman as she develops this ministry to the community. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Grant us courage to live a good Lent in word and deed, that we might seek you in prayer, honor you in fasting, and follow Christ's example with acts of kindness to others. Embolden the faithful here with your promise and your presence. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Save us from selfish use of your gifts, that we might grow in generosity in our living and giving. Send others to us who will come to Christ here and grow in his grace and love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We give thanks for the witness and testimony of the saints who have gone before us into eternal life. Let us boast in the hope they have shared, a hope that does not disappoint us. We ask you to comfort all who mourn, especially Greg Armstrong, Dave Bisson, the family of Arlis Groska, Anthony Lapari, the family of B. Volker, and Barb Hendricks and her family. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Into your hands, merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your steadfast love through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated, and our worship continues with the offering.
Let us pray. God, our provider, you have not fed us with bread alone, but with words of grace and life. Bless us in these your gifts, which we receive from your bounty, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord. You bid your people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast. Renew our zeal and faith in life and bring us to the fullness of grace that belongs to the children of God. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise to you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise to you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness to the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ. Praise to you for your Spirit poured out to sanctify creation to the full. And our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant of my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." With this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine, the body and blood of your Son. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence. Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us. With your holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, that taught at our Savior's command and rejoicing in the identity you have given us, we dare to say,
"Our Father,
the peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you. Let us offer one another a sign of God's peace.
Dear friends, this is Jesus, his body, his blood, in with and under the bread and wine, given and shed for you, because he's got gifts to give to you here this morning, his grace, his love, and his forgiveness for this time and this place. So we invite you to come and receive these gifts that he so freely gives. The table is set. Please be seated.
On the swiftest wings of morning from the high.
And now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior strengthen and preserve you in true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in his joy and in his peace. Amen.
Let us pray. Merciful God, accompany our journey through these 40 days. Renew us in the gift of baptism that we may provide for those who are poor. Pray for those who are in need. Fast from self-indulgence, and above all, that we may find our treasure in the life of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. We have just a couple of quick announcements here this morning. First of all, if you haven't made your way to our Lenten table in the gathering space, please do so. There's lots of opportunities that still exist for us as we continue in our journey through Lent. One of the opportunities coming up Tuesday, April 4th, is the Seder meal. And this meal is actually being done by Jews for Jesus. It's a great ministry. It's a great organization. And it allows us to kind of get a little bit of an authentic flavor as to what the Seder may have looked like during that Holy Week with Jesus and his disciples. So we invite you to take a look at that. There's some information about that there at the Lenten table. One thing I just want to make sure I read to you, the tickets are available through March 19th, and we ask that you reserve your seating using the envelopes that are at that table in the gathering space. And if you have any questions, please talk to Amy Neiman about those, and she'll get them answered for you. Second thing here this morning is, as you leave worship, we have Easter experience invitations for you. First of all, we'd like to begin by inviting you to come for the Easter experience of Beautiful Savior. If you're not familiar with it, it's a great event that has an Easter journey, so telling the story of Jesus during Holy Week and his cross and his empty tomb, going into some crafts and games and egg hunts and some free food. It's a great opportunity, a great event, especially for kids up to about 7 or 8 years old. So we want to invite you into that and invite you to come for that. But we have these invitations for you to take with you here today. As Pastor Tom talked about in the sermon today, you are a lot of different places, right? Your neighborhoods, your work, your family, wherever you are. And we ask that you take these and bring them to those places. Invite people that you may know who would be able to come to something like this. So please grab one of those on your way out. Also, along with that, if you are on Facebook, one of the things we're asking you to do is go to Beautiful Savior's Facebook page. And if you haven't liked it yet, please like it. But then find the Easter Experience event there and share that on your Facebook wall. That's a great opportunity to share with your friends and your family this event that's coming up here at Beautiful Savior. So a couple of different ways to invite people, taking a physical thing here or going online to the Facebook page and inviting them through your own Facebook wall. So please do that. It's a great event that shares the gospel of Jesus as well as a fun morning for the kids and families involved. Receive the blessing of our Lord. The Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever. Amen. Let us pray together. Almighty God, by our baptism into the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, you turn us from the old life of sin. Grant us to turn to you daily, that through prayer, fasting, and almsgiving, we may make a good Lent, not so much seeking to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. In repentance, remind us it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen.
Go in peace, remember the poor. Thanks be to God.